Thank you all for joining. I would like to start the webinar on a note thanking you all for registering to the data mining platform. I would be taking you guys through a PowerPoint and a couple of steps as to how you can navigate on this platform and what is crowdsourcing all about, a bit a basic concept of what you're getting into, and also the tasks that we usually see on the data mining platform. I hope this webinar would be helpful by the end of the session. A sincere request is that you do have the Q&A forum that you can utilize to sort of post your questions. However, once the session is done, I would allow you guys 15 minutes to post your questions, and myself and my colleagues would be able to provide you hopefully with the right answers. All right. On that note, let's initiate our first webinar, that is Navigate and Qualify on Datamine. So these are going to be the contents that we're going to go through. We're going to start with a brief introduction and some of the flyers that you have seen through the emails and so on and so forth. We will also check as to how we can sign up if you are a new user. And for those of you who have already signed up, there could be a couple of roadblockers which are not allowing you to log in to the platform. We would assist you in terms of how you can avoid that roadblocker and help you with the workflow as to how you can log on to the Datamine platform. That's the workflow for the old users. We would also check a few things such as the tasks, the marketplace, the guideline decoding, and so on and so forth. As we move on, you will get more acquainted with this. So welcome. Thank you for joining today's webinar. These are some of the flyers that you might have seen. This was the first flyer or the information that you have received. One thing to notice is that these three steps are extremely important. I would like to repeat these for the benefit of everyone. You have to, as a first step, create an Outlook ID and then create an account on the Datamine platform. How do I do that? You just have to use this URL, which is app.datamine.ai. And that will take you to the page where you can register yourself, sign up. But creating an Outlook ID is extremely important. I would also guide you through the steps in which you can do so. And once you do create the Outlook ID, you have to enter that as your secondary email within the sign up process. Your account will be activated within 24 hours after the Datamine registration, right? So we'll check how that happens. So moving on, excuse me, this would be the let's sign up slide where we would help you understand how the workflow goes. So I'm going to take you guys to a document. Many of you must have seen this document in the past. So the document comprises of Outlook ID creation steps and also the tool overview along with the registration, right? So let's get to the document here. All right. So this is the workflow that one needs to go through. I would also help you understand or showcase where this document can be found on the Datamine platform itself. So the very first step is to open your browser, usually a Chrome or an Edge. The latest browsers help you navigate or register quickly and easily. So go to outlook.com and create a free account, and you can give it any name you want. John.anders, for example, at outlook.com. Enter a password and move on, right? So the first step would be to create your Outlook ID. The second step would be to go to this URL. I would show you how this works. If you click on this, you see this. This is the page that you get to. This is the home page for Datamine. You can always go ahead and sign up if you are a new user over here. We shall go through those steps in a bit. Let's move back to the document steps. So This is where you sign up. You can fill in the Gmail ID. So get this straight that you would always require an email ID, preferably a Gmail ID or an Outlook ID, to enter the data mine. So you can enter the email address and click on create account. To the registered email ID that you have entered in the junk email, you would receive a hyperlink or a link to activate your account. Always remember, your registered email ID's password should be known to you. If you are in doubt about not remembering the password, always make sure you double check that and then go ahead and register yourself on Datamine. You will be redirected to the Datamine sign up page to fill in the required details, such as these, right? You have the first name, your last name, your password, your confirmed password, and the email address. You can, or you should, agree to the terms and conditions and create your account. Once you create the account, you will be redirected to the Datamine platform or the homepage once again. Post a message stating that your registration has been successful. Enter your Gmail ID or the Outlook ID that you have used to register onto Datamine and a password to login. Post login, you would be redirected to a profile setup page. Now, I am taking you guys through this document. However, I would also make the effort to showcase how you can sign up with a new Gmail ID or a new account, right? So this would be the basic info, your first name, your last name, your email that you have used to register on Datamine. And in the secondary email tab, it is extremely important that you enter your Outlook ID that you have created, right? So this is a mandatory aspect without which we would not be able to register you onto our platforms. So next comes the place of birth, the state, country, so on and so forth. You can give the place of residence as the same or whichever you think you deem is appropriate. So while updating, keep in mind this is mandatory for you. Once again, I repeat, your Outlook ID as your secondary email and also your language proficiency. So your language proficiency could be, let's say, starting with English. If you can read, if you can speak, and if you can type, you should select these. And if you are acquainted with any other languages, whether they are regional or German or French or Japanese, Mandarin, you should go ahead and select those languages as well. Why is this important? The platform will suggest or insert the tasks which are language oriented or market oriented accordingly. If you do not update the language, if you are a French specialist or a German specialist, you would not receive those tasks. Rather, you would standardly receive some English oriented tasks, right? So if you want to see market variations, you have to update the language proficiency over here. Any click work experience, interests and hobbies, please let us know. We are more than excited to understand you as a person. And then how did you get to know about Datamine? It could be through a flyer, it could be through a friend. Please update that tab as well. Now, once you do all of this, you just have to click on update profile to submit the information that you have just uploaded. It will take around 24 hours for the interface to get enabled, but once the 24 hour mark is done, you can use the same URL app.datamine.ai and you would use your credentials to log in. And the moment you log in, this is the page you get to, right? So there would be home, my app, settings and support. You have to click on my apps to check if you have any apps assigned. So post 24 hours, you will be able to see that you have some applications or tasks assigned to you, right? You will also receive a mandatory NDA form, a non-disclosure agreement that you have to tick mark on and agree. So please do that. This is one of the most important steps. And then you would be redirected to a link, right? Which we will see in a bit, in a few minutes late time. We would be clicking on all these links to understand how it works. So once you are redirected, that's when on the second page, you have to use your Outlook ID and password that you have created for yourself and not the Datamine Gmail or other email IDs. you will be redirected to a home page called a marketplace, something like this. This is where you would be able to see your tasks assigned to you or the categorization of the tasks. Keep in mind, this is for new users only. Old users who have already gone through the process, I will get to you guys in a bit. So keep in mind the number in the description on the home page, you would see certain categorizations, right? Such as search relevance, text annotation, image annotation, so on and so forth. You will also see a numerical onto the right hand side. This would sort of indicate the number of hit apps or tasks available to you to work on, right? You can feel free to choose any of those tasks and qualify yourself to start on production and to quickly start earning. All right. So if you click on search relevance, this is how the tasks would reflect. And once you click on tasks, this is your specific task where you will have a download button. This download button helps you download the guidelines. Guidelines, for FYI, are nothing but what to do and what not to do. These are the basic policies provided to you to adhere to. If you follow the guidelines thoroughly and brush these up, you would be able to qualify easily and work on the production as well. So we will get to that part later as to how you can qualify and what are the prerequisites for the same. But always go to this download button and download your guidelines. Once you have understood the guidelines and also have practiced everything, like you have attempted a couple of practice sets, now you're confident, that's when you move on to this button, the blue color one, to qualify and take the qualification test. Please keep in mind, you have to qualify in this test in order to go to production and start earning. If you do not qualify, you would be given a 24 window again, stating that you have not met the quality metric, right? So you see this, you will also see a pop-up with information after remaining qualification attempts and number of hits on the hit app or task. You click on qualify, you will also get this pop-up where you would be notified that you will receive 4 qualification attempts and there are 4 hits in this qualification test, which means 24 are the ones that you have to work on and you would have 4 qualification attempts, let's per se for this task. And these qualification or the number of attempts may vary from task to task. Please keep that in mind as well. So this is how it would pop up. And you would have to always check if you are in the qualification mode. It would be on the top. Once you click on qualify, you go ahead and give your tasks or give your hits or your answers. And you can always log out from here in case you're done with your work. There you go. And this document is available to you guys on the DataMine platform. I will show that in a bit. So hopefully if you have met the quality metrics and you have qualified the qualification, you would receive this pop-up which would say you have passed the qualification test. Click on OK. And if you have not met the quality metrics, you will receive this message technically, which would say that based on your recent work, we have noticed the quality is not in line with the task owner's expectations. We value your loyalty, so take a little break and you can come back to the hit app tomorrow. So that's how you can try it again. So for a quick display of your progress and earnings on the marketplace, you would have something like this. And you can click on report on the top. This report will indicate the number of judgments that you have made and the time that you have spent, and your earnings would also be visible over here. If you are unable to log in after 24 hours of your registration or you're unable to see any apps assigned to you, you can always reach out to this address, which is crowdsupport@zen3tech.com. We have a support team which works 24/7 to assist you on your work from home journey, right? On that note, hope all of you guys are doing well and are safe. Let's begin our journey also to understand how one would sign up on one of these platforms, right? So let me go ahead and showcase this. So like I said, this is the URL that you would have to use, app.datamime.ai. I click on that. I'm taken to this homepage, right? So on the homepage, assume, okay, let me take a new ID for myself, although I have one registered, and show you how to sign up. So in the sign up, assume I'm entering a new ID, right? So I would use a random Gmail ID. In this case, you would have to use your Gmail ID that you have, that you're using or that you're registered. And keep in mind, if you are a click worker or an analyst working for any other organization or any other platforms using the same Outlook ID or any other ID, please do not use that here. You would have to create a new Outlook ID, right? So let's start with creating a new account. Oh, sorry, my bad. Let's add. This invite is sent to my email, right? So let me see. So I'll try to open my gmail.com with the one that I have just signed in with. Hope I'm entering the right password. Let's see if I can. Sure. So what we are trying to do here, we are trying to access our Gmail that we have just used to register ourselves or sign up. And click on the activate account page, right? So this seems to be a Datamime registration. So this would be the email that you would receive, Datamime registration email verification. So go ahead and click on this, right? Activate account. This should take you to this part where I can, you know, enter my first name and my last name. That and create a password. So once I have created and confirmed the password, I agree to the terms and conditions, right? And I go ahead and create an account. All right. Please keep in mind, I have used my gmail.com with this ID. Now it is telling me that my registration is successful. And I can sign in to continue, right? So I'm going to use my Gmail ID or the ID that I've used for registration and try to log in once again. I've just created a password, so I'll use that password and not my Gmail password to log in. And bingo, you have this page where you can upload your photograph, right? And also your basic info such as your name, your last name, everything is visible over here. Like I mentioned on the workflow document, it's important that you always add a secondary email, and it's a mandatory one, which would be your Outlook ID. So I have an Outlook ID that I can, you know, sort of enter over here. I'm gonna enter my Outlook ID that I've created earlier as my secondary email. My place of birth, so let's take it as Hyderabad, and this is in Telangana. country would be India, duration of say randomly 10. You can update the same details over here or your details, whichever you see fit, right? Intent, your personal info, right? You can always go with your personal info, and then your ethnicity, that would be here. You can give out your number as well, right? Your mobile number, so that you receive all the notifications from DataMine in terms of your passwords or any immediate reach out programs that we do, inclusive of the links. So language proficiency, extremely important. So, assuming I know English and I can speak it professionally, write it professionally, and also type it professionally, that's what I would enter. You can enter your education over here, your license and certifications, if any. That will be of great help because we would know what you have done and where do your skills lie, your experience. In what industry, is it banks, is it communication services, consumer services, what was your role and the duration of engagement, so on and so forth, right? Click work experience, if any, interests and hobbies, for example, golf, project info, reference, how do I know? I am an employee, so I will go ahead and click I'm a Zen 3 Tech employee, and that's how I know about DataMine. Most importantly, two things, secondary email and also your language proficiency, right? Once you have entered, click on update. This should technically update your profile and it should probably, once the registration is done, take 24 hours to complete. We will allow this a minute to update. Thank you. So now that we have this, we can always check if there is anything missing that we have not updated. So this mobile number cannot be empty. So let's go ahead and check this as well and update your profile. So the profile updated successfully. This would be your home page that you see. So once you receive the DataMine profile page, this is the most important part, my apps. There are no apps assigned yet. However, once the apps are assigned, I would be able to click on this to start. I will show you how to do that in a bit. Most importantly, you can always click on profile and make those changes, right? On your profile. So there is also support. So you have a lot of FAQs over here which you can go through, and FAQs are again categorized. How can you register? How can I log in? For example, I have a question such as what is UHRS? I always have this answer over here. So importantly, there are two things. One, the process and payments related documents. One is the process related info, the one that I have just showcased in the beginning. This document is available on DataMine. You can always go to that and click here and get this document. You can also download, feel free to do so. And let's say you also have something called payment related information. So if you click on this, you have a document. And you have to register with Guru by clicking on this link below. Read and understand the payment procedure and the withdrawal process. And you have a couple of links as well. You can select the mode of payment and add a transfer method. And in spite of doing all of this, if you still have any additional queries, you can always reach out to us at crowdsupport@zen3tech.com, right? So those were a couple of basic things that I wanted you guys to know or get started with. So what I'm going to do right now is go back to DataMine, log out, and use my profile that I've used in the past, right? So this is my profile. Before we go ahead and click on start, let us go back to our PowerPoint to understand a couple of more aspects that we deem necessary, right? So this is the sign up aspect that I spoke about. Hope this is clear. Now let's talk a bit about crowdsourcing, right? So crowdsourcing is technically a model, right, wherein all individuals or public or anyone or organizations obtain services, including ideas, finances, or micro tasks or tasks in general, from a large, relatively open and oftenly evolving, rapidly evolving group of participants. So the participants would be us. We are trying to sort of look for services that we can work on. And this whole concept is known as crowdsourcing. How is this helpful? Crowdsourcing, the best part is you can work from anywhere you want. You can earn from anywhere you want. It is not mandatory to come down to a location or a space to work. You just need a home internet bandwidth connection. And it's going to be great because the tasks that are assigned to you are very well defined. And you can just go through the tasks and start clicking on things, giving your outputs, and almost instantaneously start earning, right? Quick and easy way of earning money or your dollars. This platform could be useful in terms of getting you the right experience in click working and also analyzing certain tasks for bigger brands. So now that we understand a bit about crowdsourcing, let's also talk about the workflow for the old users. Okay, most importantly, we have revised our, you know, data mine version. So there is this new UI that you're seeing right now, right? So the new UI has a lot of, blockers for the people who have registered in the past. So what I'm going to do is help you understand how and what will work for your old registrations. Let's move on to the next slide in this. So if you are an old registered DataMime user, go back to this URL, which I have mentioned earlier, app.datamime.ai, and click on forgot password, right? Do not try to log in with your old credentials. Use the same email ID, however, click on forgot password. The page will redirect you to a password reset page. You will receive a 6-digit OTP to your email address, which you can use to quickly enter over here. And that's how you can reset your password. And once you have reset your password, you will be taken to the profile setup page. And that's about it. You have to just change your password to enter into the latest registration or the latest UI user interface of DataMime. I hope this would be useful for people who consider this as a roadblocker. Having said that, let's move on to the marketplace and report tab. All right, this is the juncture in which I would like to take you to the platform DataMime and show you how we can go to the task homepage, right? So I have this hyperlink, click on start. This always shows me the progress. So I'm going to click on this to see where it takes me. This is where you get to. This is Universal Human Relevance System. This is where your tasks are assigned to you. So click on sign in. Now this is the page I was trying to mention, that you always have to use your Outlook ID and not your Gmail ID or the DataMime email ID that you have used. So the Outlook ID that you have created would be helpful here. For quick copy paste, I have them here. So I'm going to sign in with my Outlook ID. Right. All right. Let me enter my password as well. If I enter the right credentials, I would be taken to something called a marketplace. And there you go. So in general, you would be able to see these categorization of tasks. So the best part about crowdsourcing or freelance work that you're doing on DataMine is that you can choose from a category. If you are a person who likes to sort of identify a sentiment of a tweet and document classification on similar lines, get into text annotation. If you are a person who thinks you can understand the pop culture or the market or entities or understand the user intent better, you can always click on search relevance and get into these tasks. If you are good at, you know, you remember, if you remember the Deccan Chronicle or what the newspaper Spot the Difference articles that you used to do as a kid, if you are good at spotting the differences, if you are good at observatory skills, get into image annotation. If you're patient enough, and you patience is your virtue, and you can observe certain aspects that others cannot, get into video annotation, and so on and so forth. So there are going to be a lot of classifications which we are going to give you to work on. So let's try to get into one of these categories to see how it works. I have just clicked on text annotation, in which I have 8 in total. These are the tasks assigned to me that I can work on. So let me help you understand how it works. So if this is the task that I want to get into, does user want to buy something in English? So I feel I can do this task per se, and it gives me the price per hit and the available ones. 108.8k hits are available for you to work on, and I have 24 seconds per hit. However, what is the most important part of this? You have to first go to the guideline document and try to download it, right? So that's what I would do first, even before getting into anything. So once I look at the guideline document, it's important for me to spend an hour or two to thoroughly go through the project overview. What does it say, and how do I rate these? Are there any examples or hints and tips given to me? So for example, if this is a type of query, right? So there could be non-retail website queries, there could be entity queries, there could be informational queries, and there are certain examples as well, which are given here, with no retail intent, with retail intent, excuse me. For these aspects, you can always check these examples, get thorough with these, and once you're good with the guidelines and you are very confident, you can go to something called training. If you click on this, you would be given certain tasks that you can practice on, right? So you can click on non-retail intent and retail intent to strengthen your own concepts. So once you're done with, for example, I click on retail intent since I have read the guidelines, this is how your page would reflect as. Here you can see I am in a training mode and not the qualification mode. It says, does this query have product purchase potential? So this is Forte de Santo Antonio da Beira, Brazil. If you are a person, you can understand this, that is fine. If you do not, you have to research it, right? So I'm going to give you a quick demo of how to do it. I'm going to research on Google or Bing. So research is the key, right? So I'm going to understand what this is. This is Forte de Santo Antonio, is a fort located in Salvador, Bahia, Brazil. So I understand that this is a tourist attraction. So I'll go back to the task to see what I can do. So it's asking me if it has a retail intent, or if it doesn't have a retail intent, or if it is non-English. So how do I know what to select? Important, you have to go through the guidelines. Once you go through and read them thoroughly, you would be able to work on the guidelines. So having said that, assume that I understand these. This is a snapshot from the guideline itself. So what is a non-retail, what is entity, what is informational? So I'm going to go with yes, because there could be some retail intent attached to people trying to visit the place as well, and I'm going to hit on submit. What happens when you hit on submit? It says my response was correct. So this is the best way to learn in training. It would also give you feedback stating that there is retail intent. What could be the reason? Search results show related retail intents like tours, like we just discussed. there are many English language results for this place name, so it isn't treated as a non-English query. It's important to understand the query intent and then go to the guideline, see what could be referred in the guideline for you to answer quickly and take your best judgment. So that being said, I'm going to accept this feedback and I'm going to move on. So that's how you practice in the training mode. I'm going to leave for now and get back to demonstrating the other tabs. So in this task, I also have something called a preview. If you are a person who is finicky about, very particular about what sort of tasks you want to get into, you can always click on preview and it would give you a basic preview of how this task is going to look like, and it would say preview mode, right? So Budweiser's talk, let's just say, yeah, who wouldn't like a Budweiser? So just click on this. There you go. The judgment is not correct. Why? Because this is a general research and there is no retail intent to purchase or so on and so forth. If I'm a person who is quick or who has not gone through the guidelines quickly and making those errors in quickly attempting the answer, you might go wrong. But nevertheless, if you're in a training mode, take the feedbacks very seriously and then go on to the qualification mode, right? So that's the preview that I was talking about. Let's go back again, excuse me, to the marketplace. You see this, you can always leave feedback, you can download guidelines, you can get into the training mode over here, and you can also have a preview of the task itself. Assume I am not qualifying on this task, or I have completed all the training sets. I want to qualify on this task. You can click on qualify. When you click on this, it would give you a pop-up which would say you will have 3 qualification attempts and there are 15 hits in the qualification test itself. If you do confirm, your qualification will initiate. So that's where we say all the very best to you, right? So I do not like the task. I have not qualified. Feel free to go to another task and help yourself with the guidelines and try to qualify. This is text annotation. You could do similar things in the other categories or segments that I spoke about, such as search relevance. If I am to do the same thing, I would download the guideline and then probably look at a preview and also get into the training sets and only then hit on qualify, right? So this happens to be your marketplace. If you want to see how many, once you qualify, how many aspects or how many hits have you performed and what are your earnings, you should always click on the report. You would be able to see a lot of tabs over here. Everything is transparent. You will see the potential earnings, amount earned in US dollars without with no incentives. There could be certain tasks which would incentivize, which would be incentivized, and you can earn more money or more dollars in the same. You can always check your total earnings, right, and the number of judging hours. You can always go with the date range as well. If you have worked from a certain date in the past month to a certain date, you want to check the overall earnings or overall report, you can always go by week, day, month, year, so on and so forth, right? So this is pretty much what I wanted to showcase before I went on to the marketplace and report tab. So this document is going to be made available to you eventually, maybe in a day or two on Datamime itself, the one that I'm using right now. Until then, you can go practically onto the marketplace and check for all these tabs. So we have documented these slides for your reference. All these tabs are self-explanatory. This is the date range that I just spoke about. And these are the descriptions as what you could see in the report tab. So moving on from that, we are now going to look at the task overview. At the moment, you would be able to see text annotation and search relevance. Let us get a bit familiarized with the text annotation terminologies or lingos so that you have a basic idea of what you're getting into, right? Let's get you acquainted with that. So in terminologies, you see these query, right? So what is a query? Query is a search term, right? I go to a browser, I am an end user, you know, having my popcorn on a lazy boy, and I want to just, you know, search for something in a search engine. Let's say I enter Nike. This Nike happens to be my query. I am querying something, but when I type Nike, where do I want to go? Maybe I want to go to the official website, but if I'm typing Nike shoes, maybe I want to purchase Nike shoes, isn't it? So the intent of me entering this term could vary, but in reality, the query intent could be generic, specific, non-generic, could be about a brand, could be about a product, could be anything, very random, right? I can just type Nike Green. Now, it could be a name, but most probable intent is that someone would like a Nike Green shoe because they are most known for shoes in their merchandise, right? So just giving you a basic idea of what a query would mean. It could be a group of or a set of words together, or it could just be a simple term, right? So intent is what the user is looking for. It maybe they want a website to receive information or a website to purchase a product. Judgments, this is what you do, right? All of us being a click worker or an analyst, we need to take that decision and come to a sensible conclusion. There is a logic, there is a lot of logic and common sense that needs to be involved to make a judgment. There could be certain queries which could be very ambiguous. Ambiguous is there is no clear intention, right? So I'm just gonna type this, Nike GD. There is no clear intention on what I'm trying to ask, right? So these are no clear intention or ambiguous scenarios that you might encounter. What would I do with those? You have a set of guidelines. You have to go through those thoroughly to understand what you need to do when it comes to ambiguous scenarios, right? Labeling is the process of coming to a sensible conclusion. Product class. Some of you might have gone through this term called product class. Let me explain what it is. These terms indicate a type or a class of the product the user probably wants. For example, you have Samsung digital camera or Dyson vacuum cleaners. So the product class over here is a digital camera and a vacuum cleaner, right? So that's how, and the Samsung and Dyson become the brands. For example, you will also come across something called a model. A model is a unique number, name or lines given to each product made by the manufacturers, right? You have an iPhone 10 or an iPhone 12 or a Samsung S20 or Galaxy Tab. For example, you have HP Pro 200 M251NW, right? If I remove the HP Pro and give you just the 200 M251NW, you might not probably understand. So it's important that when you get queries like this, you research them enough to understand the intent or the term itself, right? So in this case, it is considered to be a model. HP is the brand. It's just a laser jet color printer from HP. Now, there could be certain queries where, you know, there are certain terms such as adjectives which are attached to a product class, such as in this example, you see this kids drawing books. Drawing books is the product class, but kids and plus size would define the specification of what exactly the user intends to seek, right? So it's important that you understand what a spec attribute is. This is in one of the tasks within the text annotation. Brands are simple. We all understand brands. What is Dove? Dove is a brand. LG is a brand. Samsung is a brand. Hyundai. So all these are brands. If you do not know a brand, what do you do, right? So brands are again categorized into two. One could be a non-generic brand, such as a widely recognized name or logo such as Canon, Dell, Nike, etc. And there could be a generic brand. You see certain brands that the names or the terms are so generic, such as AK Puppet or Visare. So you don't know if these are brands or what. So you need to probably research enough. And once you research, you will realize that it is a local snack brand and Visare is a local electronic manufacturer, right? So that's how you distinguish between a generic and a non-generic brand. Merchant. Let's talk a bit about merchant, right? A business that sells products from brands, right, are called or known as merchants. At times, a term such as Amazon could be a brand and also a merchant, such as they make their own products or they also provide their products to other stores or online shopping sites or aggregator sites to sell, right? So Amazon as a company is a merchant, and Amazon also gives its Amazon Echo. You could buy it from any other site if you wish to. So product and brand, those are known as merchants. Let's look at a couple of examples maybe. So if this is your query, butenaphine. Upon query research, you find that butenaphine is a synthetic chemical sold under different brands. So this is one of the tasks where you would be asked to categorize into a model, product class, spec attribute, and unknown if you do not know what to do. First things first, you have to go through the guidelines, right? And from the guideline reference, so for every query that you have to have a guideline reference, and that's how you decode or clear your qualifications. So you see it as a model, a model line of different brands, like in the example HP, this model, where this model number is considered as a model itself. So for a model, what is my guideline reference? Products are often accompanied by model names, lines, or model numbers. For example, Adobe Acrobat She Pro Prices, or a 2007 Ford Edge, Creme Brulee Clear Coat. So in these things, what do? I know that this happens to be a model and this happens to be a brand. So you would enter it over here. And in this case, butenaphine, what did you select? Butenaphine is the specific model of an antifungal drug that the user wants. And hence, when you have given the product class, the model, it is telling you that your judgment has been correct, right? So you can go to the next one, which says frog and toad together. Upon research, you understand that there is a writer by the name Arnold Lobel, and it's a book, right? Again, guideline reference, you take it, and you have to segregate your terms within the model category. Frog, toad together would come under this class, and when you do that, it would tell you if your judgment has been correct or wrong. Let's see this, best rated garage floor epoxy. What is floor epoxy? That's something you should always research. But when you have terms like this, best rated, etc., they are in the sought order category. How do I know it is in the sought order category? Because there is a guideline reference which clearly tells me that in sought order, if I have terms such as best, cheap, older, most comfortable, top, etc., then I have to categorize them into the sought order. So that's how I've categorized my our terms into this, right? So it's extremely important, again, I repeat, to go through the guidelines and time and again refer to them. So this is going to be similar to what we have just discussed. Our text annotation works that way, and in search relevance, the query, intent, judgment, and ambiguous are one and the same. But there is something also called a core concept that you will come across in your guidelines. The main idea being searched for within a multiple word query is known as the core concept. For example, if there is a query called men's track shoes, what is the core concept in this? It's shoes. Why is it important for you to know the core concept? Because it's easier for you to understand the intent And once you understand the intent, it is easier for you to classify and compare it with another keyword as well, right? In search relevance. So attributes, this is simply a word that modifies the query by limiting its meaning by additional descriptors, right? Let me give you an example. If your query is gloves and you have another query which is baseball gloves, baseball technically narrows the definition of the query, and hence the baseball becomes the attribute. So you have to thoroughly read your queries this way as to, okay, what is my core concept and what is my attribute? Specificity, right? The quality of belonging or relating uniquely to a particular subject. You must have come across this term if you have already gone through the guidelines in one or two tasks. So how is it important? So when I know that I am searching for shoes, right, that is my word query, and I get, you know, another keyword which says women's shoes, I know that shoes is a broader term and women's shoes happens to be narrow. So that's where I specify that, okay, the specificity is narrowing down from the query towards the keyword, and hence I will apply a guideline reference over there. So it's important for you to understand whether if you are given a query and a keyword, whether a term is narrower than the keyword or it is broader than the keyword itself. So I would not want to go into the depth of the subject as of now, but just helping you understand what broader categories look like. One which covers a larger number or wide scope of subjects such as shoes, electronics, etc., would come under broader categories. If you have something like a Nike running shoe, a Samsung mobile, or an iPhone 10, that would be a narrower category. A couple of examples here for your reference. If you see the query, smoked turn signals for 2000 F-350 diesel, right? So if you understand the query intent correctly, what they are asking for is for a 2000 Ford F-350 car, they want a turn signal light. But what did you get as an ad? You got a Recon model number, Super Duty side mirror lenses, right? So ad offers a Super Duty mirror lens for Ford model cars. Do you think it is right? It is not, right? Simply because they are looking for a turn signal and you are being given, you know, a side lens. So hence you rate it as bad. The guideline reference is here. Wrong type of product. The query was PS4 and it was giving them wrong product type. The user is looking for a console and not games, so the product type doesn't match. So if you are getting into this task, it's important that you check if it is a match or a mismatch, thoroughly go through the guidelines and rate accordingly. We have given you a couple of more examples. The query happens to be picture frames and you have a keyword which says home decor frames. So in these, no matter if the person is looking for picture frames, even if he gets ads or keywords which are home decor frames, those match correctly, because interchangeably adding the words home decor does not change the meaning, intent or specificity itself, and hence we are rating it as excellent. You have a guideline reference for the same, which says plane tickets and flight tickets. We know both of them intend the same thing, and hence we say that it is an exact match. So that's about the text annotation and the search relevance. I would like to quickly skim through these for your reference. This document is going to be available to you eventually, but you have to download the guideline document, go through the goal, go through query. If you do not understand something, go through it time and again, or simplify your subject reading itself, right? And also practice a bit. You know, once you get to the practice sets, it's easier for you to go back to the guidelines and forth to understand if you're doing things correctly, right? These are all practice sets and references that you might get. For example, you have a query in text ads, right? Important entities task. Someone wrote a query called Christmas Trees UK. So if you have to classify the term into these categories, location refers to any term that can be used to indicate an exact geographic location. So for you, UK would come under the location, and that's about it. So yeah, practice sets are going to be a lot. The more you practice, the more easier it becomes for you to attempt the qualification. Some of the tips and best practices that we suggest are that you research the query in the search engine for better understanding of the intention behind the specific research. Understanding the intent behind the user's query is extremely important. If you have a query such as John Lewis black dress, the intent of the query is to buy John Lewis brand's black colored dress. That's how you need to decode. And users can be random. They could just write J. Lewis black dress as well. If it is an alternative brand, search for it. If it is not, then you have to research enough to understand the intent is John Lewis brand black colored dress. Follow the specific terminologies to understand the difference in the user intent. For example, Amazon Echo, we have discussed this a moment ago. Amazon should be considered as a brand, as Echo is the only product of is only a product of Amazon, right? So we strongly encourage reviewing both the instructions for each rating and examples provided. So your likelihood of your performance goes higher if you research enough. For example, the monsoon UK, right? So every query, the way you look at it might not give you the direct intent of the user query. And this is an expected behavior. For example, you have something called Monsoon UK. If you research, you will understand that it is a brand and not for a monsoon store or for weather. And hence, understanding the intent is extremely important. And the most probable intent or the popular intent is what you go by as per the guideline references as well. On the whole, for me to just tell you that this is what you need to do in simple four steps, I would take the effort to read these out loud. Reading and understanding the guidelines thoroughly, your first task. Attempt the practice sets and understand the feedback provided. Diligently perform your research and try to expand your horizons and think of what the user is probably researching for. Give an appropriate rating or your answer based on the intent understanding. And most importantly, the guideline references. Without guidelines, there is no practice, there is no qualification. All right, cool. Once again, just being a bit obsessive about this, we would like to remind you that you have to add your Outlook ID as your secondary email and also your language proficiency over here for you to be assigned a few tasks. Thank you so much.